I wanted to take this opportunity to make a film that was first off very different, very bold, and perhaps very controversial. Through that idea, we went through several drafts of what episode 5 could have been. Settling for curtains was really the only way I saw fitting for Peter's journey and the overall closing for the Spider-Man series. For me, those elements of bold, different, controversial, that overall makes for something unique in its own regard. And that, for me, is filmmaking at its best.
When Ryan first came to me with the script to Spider-Man, and he asked me to be Peter Parker, I didn't really think I could do it. I didn't think really I was up for it, but I was definitely down to give it my all and try. And especially with the tone of our series thus far, it's been a lot more different. So getting into the role of the character wasn't too hard. But when it came to this episode particularly, all the kind of ideas I had of how to play our Peter Parker, not Allergies Peter Parker, weren't really necessarily thrown out the window, but they were given a backseat in a sense that it was more about, this is someone who's been through trauma, who's been through pain, and they want to react realistically. And Ryan even sat me down. He said, I'm not looking for an Oscar-worthy performance. I'm looking for something real. And that really struck a chord with me, as in, okay, this isn't about overacting and yelling and going the full nine yards. Some of it's about that, but it was more about the subtlety in the character and, you know, their facial reactions and the things that they would say and how their body language is. It's a lot of... a lot of context just in that subtlety of how they're feeling. And what I wanted to get out of that character was I wanted to make the audience not only feel for Peter, but really understand that because he's gone through that kind of trauma, and you can see it on his face, you can see it within his whole body, tone of voice, everything, that you can kind of understand a little bit of where he came from and how he became the Spider-Man he is.
My part was, it was hard for me. Physically, it was hard. Emotionally, it was hard. This character is slightly different compared to the other characters in my previous films. The raw emotions that I had to search for Ben is he knows that he's guilty for the crime that he committed, and he doesn't know what to do with himself. I don't think that he's that he looks at himself as a human being or a man. He just exists. And I think that took away who he is as a person. It was challenging. I know a lot of actors use that word, challenging. It's different. It's exhausting. I was concerned to do a retake because of the physical energy that I had to put up, and the demand in the scene where my nephew and I get into a scuffle.
So when I was asked if I would be interested in playing Mary Jane in a Spider-Man series, I was kind of like, hello, is this a daydream? Because Mary Jane is a character that has meant a lot to me, and she's such an iconic character, female character from comics, that it really was an honor to be able to play her, but it was also a lot of pressure, not only to live up to that legacy, but to live up to all the expectations of the people who've been putting their all into making this series, and all of the people who have been watching and supporting the series from the very beginning. It's a lot of pressure to, you know, want to live up to their expectations and give viewers what, you know, they deserve. It's a very impactful ending. It's a very powerful ending. It's maybe a very unexpected ending, and that's very fun to dive into.
Curtains at the end of the day is what Peter as a character deserves. Not what the audience wants, perhaps, but what the story needs. That was a very important rule that I followed as I wrote episode 5, and also a very important rule while I was directing it. This was only going to cater to the story, you know, a rule a lot of filmmakers disregard.
When we came up with the new idea for the series finale's curtains, I already knew that I needed more intimate close-ups with Peter, and I also wanted some long Kubrick-style shots. I knew how different this episode would be, and I wanted to make sure that this episode and the previous ones were almost night and day. I saw so much potential in this episode being the character study that it was to be something very special to the viewers. I wanted to make a point that even though we don't have these fast cuts and rapid fire style of editing, that the film would still flow smoothly and keep your attention pulled. And during the premiere, that's exactly what was happening. Everyone's eyes would not leave the screen for a second. It was a very beautiful moment for a cinematographer and editor, for sure.
I tend to get lost in scenes. I could be behind the crew filming a scene, and for a few minutes, everything disappears from me. It's just me and the characters. The emotional energy transport me into a mock reality, and I feel vulnerable. That for me was my actors pushing the boundaries. That for me was the end goal being achieved.
For the fights, Ryan and I wanted to do something different. We didn't want it to be like the other episodes where their fights were more slow, lackluster, and generally uninteresting. We wanted to feel more realistic. Now, Ryan always wanted to make Rhino's character use more pro wrestling moves, like he just wanted him to be larger. So that gave me the idea of making everyone fight in a totally different way, like no one does the same attacks. For choreography, we used like styles from boxing, a little bit of Cali, some Krav Maga, and of course for Rhino, pro wrestling. And that made the fight feel really different. And what makes both fights special is that if you notice, Spider-Man's actions are all reactions to what Sin Eater, my character, and what Rhino do. You'll notice that a lot of his attacks are counters to the villain's attacks, and it gives a different feeling of Spider-Man not really attacking, but he's like defending for his life. I really hope you guys enjoyed this choreography. I worked hard and I really put some thought into it to make it feel different. I didn't want it to be slow. I wanted it to be more quick, like brutal, fast, and especially for Rhino's fight. I didn't choreograph it, but I approved of what Ryan and Phil, the main actor, came up with. And I really think that it just gives a different feeling, and it's not like seeing the same fight twice. So I really hope you guys enjoy it.
I just want to say, Ben?
Oh! Well!
Hello everyone, Marco from the Nut Allergy Productions team, and today I'm here to talk about and analyze three very important scenes from the Spider-Man Episode 5 Curtains finale. Maybe the biggest in the movie and for the series. It is the pinnacle, and that is the Uncle Ben scene. So we had Phil, of course, as Peter. Pat as Uncle Ben. Both acted so well. Really, really fun and awesome to hang out with Pat and Phil as well. Pat being an amazing guy. And with that came his really amazing acting for such a key role. And so originally, Ryan sat us down. This was before we started filming. Ryan sat us down, talking over the script, nailing out the storyline and whatnot. And then we got to this scene. Sort of everyone in the room knew how important this scene was for the story, but also for the movie. And the more and more we got into filming and whatnot, we knew we had to nail this scene. We had to nail this scene for the story, as I said, for the movie. We had to nail it because it elaborates on Peter's individual character, Uncle Ben's individual character. And once again, this was sort of the magnum opus. This is the pinnacle of the movie in this series. And so this scene was actually filmed twice before we settled on the cut that entered, well, twice in total, once we had to film it, and then one time, the last one we settled on for the one that went to the film. And so the first time we filmed, we did a lot of character work with the actors. We did a lot of also a sort of environmental stimulation to get the actors into sort of a mindset or into a sort of feeling of the scene. So we used things like music, like heat, like the cold, sort of messing up and making the environment dirty, kind of how Uncle Ben maybe would keep it, to get everybody immersed into the role. So first time that we filmed it, we thought we really, really nailed it, especially with all the hard work we put in, all the time we took, all the resources we used. It was also a really good job from everyone, from the actors, from the crew. But there were unfortunately just some technical problems that arose, and we couldn't use the footage. And now this was really, really heartbreaking. I thought, well, we can't use the footage. And there's no way, like, I thought, there's no way we can do this again. It was already amazing. Like, it was almost perfect the first time. We can't top this. And so there was sort of a general sentiment like that. Like, you know, I don't want to say we were too stressed or insanely worried, but it was definitely, we're thinking, like, this is going to be really, really hard to try and do this, what we did, again. But, you know, what we do on Not Allergy Productions, we persevered and we did it again. You know, and we were worried going into it, hoping that everything can be nailed like last time. But once we got there, we were able to get everyone right back into the right mindset that they had the first time. And even more so, too, once again, with the use of lighting, mood, music, physical makeup of the environment. But also one key thing was Ryan, the director, told each actor sort of something different to make the scene feel spontaneous, combustible, or tense, or with sort of like a fearful edge to it. And that definitely, definitely played out really, really well in the film. So yeah, there was like a tension where everyone knew. There was also a tension where everyone knew we had to beat what we did last time. And so we sat down, we buckled up, and we nailed it. And this scene was even better, surprisingly, than what we did in the first time. It was so good, so real, and so raw that some of the crew had to leave the room or pause to take a break because it was too stimulating. It definitely struck out a lot of heartstrings. It definitely brought back some memories. It definitely played with our emotions. And rewatching, or even watching it the first time, when the film was finished, it really was a spectacle. It really was something amazing to watch. Everything from how the actors acted in the scene to the editing and filming. Really, 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 really amazing. Now, touching on a specific moment in the scene that always gets me is when Uncle Ben takes his life. And in that moment, when it cuts to Peter with the blood splashed on his face, really, really, really liked how we emphasized sort of the shell ejecting and the ringing noise. There's nothing else you can hear. You can't hear any commotion, can't hear anything else, can't hear any other sound other than that ringing constant noise, almost like a silence, but in noise form it was constant. So even in that scene, you think that it's going to get better after Peter is done talking to Uncle Ben. You know, Peter lets out a little smile, but then it turns to Uncle Ben. Uncle Ben has the gun in his hand, and that gets me every time, on top of the ringing noise right after that. Also really good is how the scene ends, where he is outside at night with the ambulance police lights, you know, blood on his face, and then it cuts to the next day, morning. I don't know why, but that always really, really, really got me. On top of that, both days were also really, really fun. Hanging out with the actors, all the acting, hanging out with the crew, and just overall making some really, 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 really good content. But I can't iterate enough that nailing it a second time was very crucial, especially for this extremely important scene. And everybody was able to do that.